His words cut the silent night. Take my hand, for the child that you carry is God's own. And though it seems the road is long, we're not that far from Bethlehem, where all our hope and joy begins. Far in our arms we'll cherish him. We're not that far from
series. Last week I was looking at the first prophecy of the coming of Jesus, and that's found, as you know, if you were here, in Genesis 3. And that prophecy was from God to all of creation. When God spoke that day, he was speaking to all the earth. Here in Genesis 12, we'll be looking at in just a moment. In Genesis 12, 1 through 3, we find God speaking to Abraham. Okay? And he's revealing some very specific truths about Jesus and the way that Jesus will come to save those who repent of sin and believe the gospel. Will you pray with me? Father, we do thank you for loving us. You know, in time past, you did speak to a man. You spoke to all the creation, and then you spoke to an individual. And you let him know that there would be a coming of a Savior. You let him know this very plainly, as it's revealed to us even in the New Testament. And Lord, now we know that as you spoke to all of creation, now since Abraham, when you spoke to him, and he responded to you in the only way that we can, and that's by faith, you speak to all of us as individuals. Lord, it is our belief that your scripture teaches that you speak to every man, woman, boy, and girl at some point, letting them know that there is a Savior. God, we ask you, those of us that know that to be true, that in this time, this season, that we thank you for sending Jesus. Help us to remember that he came and lived among us, that we might recognize our need to repent of our sin, our need to embrace his gospel. Lord, we ask you that we lift him up to that. We thank you for so many blessings, God. You bless us. We are negligent. We thank you. Father, sometimes we even would think that maybe that we're not as well blessed as someone else. God, forgive us of that. Help us to recognize that all is a blessing. Father, help us to even understand, those of us who are believers, that sufferings and tribulations and trials and aggravations are those things which you use to hold us in the shape of your sin. Help us to see. Help us to see. God, use this to let us realize that the blessing of Christmas is in Jesus, and that shall be for you. In his name we pray. Amen. Now I want you to listen to this prophecy right here. And I want you to notice something. Notice that the one presenting this again is none other than God the Father himself, okay? Don't ever forget, the first mention of the gospel was not from some preacher somewhere, okay? The first mention of the gospel was not some guy with shiny white shoes and slick back white hair and a blazing red blazer somewhere telling you to send him money. That's not how the gospel started, folks. I know that we live in a world where we have been bitten so many times by so many different thieves, if you will, and those that profiteer off the word of God. But never forget, the gospel was first spoken by God himself. And his claims on us are from him. Our accountability is to him. And he always intended to save sinners. And that is what? That's the good news. And that's what we ought to be happy with every day of our life. For we are all sinners. We have all failed. And let me tell you something. Don't blow up. Don't fill yourself too full of pride. You're going to fail again. And let me tell you something else. It's not going to be long from now. Okay? It'll be sometime today. But because Jesus came, we have hope. And that is truly the Christmas blessing. Listen to Genesis 12, if you will, beginning in the first verse. These words God spoke to Abram, and who we all know as Abraham, and I'll probably just call him Abraham all the time because, frankly, it's easier to say Abraham than Abram if you're from the South. See? All right. Now listen to this. Now the Lord said to Abram, go forth from your country and from your relatives and from your father's house to the land which I will show you. And I will make you a great nation. And I will bless you and make your name great. And so you shall be a blessing. And I will bless those who bless you. And the one who curses you, I will curse. And in you, all the families of the earth will be blessed. Now, I could go off on that third verse really quick and remind us that we're always to pray for Israel because, listen, who is Abraham truly the father of? The nation of Israel. All that other stuff was secondary. And if we were going through Genesis, we would talk about that, all that secondary stuff. When Abraham got himself in trouble, and he had that little fling with Hagar. Of course, his wife talked him into it. But I don't think he resisted much. But anyway, here's the deal. Listen, the truth is that we need to remember, pray for Israel. And it's still reality, folks. You bless Israel, God blesses you. You curse Israel, it's going to be a rough time. Okay? Now, it may not be today, but it's coming. All right? It's coming. Watch, and see. But listen to this. In this very passage I just read to you, there are two subjects that are really a great part of all of human history. Now, and it's a great part of human history for the remainder of time as you and I know it. The things that God revealed to Abraham on that particular day affect humankind forever until Jesus comes back. And that's just true. One great subject here that we read is the beginning of Abraham's journey with God. Now, if you read the book of Joshua, you read the 24th chapter of Joshua, you find that Abraham did live in the land of his father, Terah, and they did worship idols. But God called Abraham out of that. Okay? And that's a wonderful thing, too. You know what? People everywhere need to understand that there's never been but one perfect human being born other than Jesus, and that was Adam. And then Adam fell into sin, and he is a sinner. And we're all sinners. And Abraham was not born just following God. There was a time when he worshiped the gods of his father. But what did God do? God did the very same thing that he does for every man, woman, boy, and girl in the world. He called him out. And he revealed himself to him. And the scripture teaches us, especially in the New Testament, but it also teaches us in Genesis 2, that by faith, Abraham followed God. All right? And that should be good news to us. We need to understand this about Abraham. He was a man. He was not some kind of small God. He was a flesh and blood human being that God called out. Did Abraham have problems? Yes. Did Abraham sin against God? Yes, he did. But what is the big thing about Abraham? He trusted God. Now, that should be something to us every day of our lives, that we follow Jesus, and it's not about how good we are. It is about the fact that he is absolutely holy, he is absolutely consistent, and it's him who holds us. We do not hold him. Okay? Now, I know we sing a lot of songs, and I don't fuss about those songs, but some of the songs we sing sometimes when we say, I'm holding to the unchanging hand, that's a good song, and I sing it too. But I want to tell you something, that's not really how that works. It is the unchanging hand that holds us, Never, ever forget that. And from this moment right here, when God made a promise to this man, Abraham, he made a covenant, if you will. He held him in his hand, and he does the same thing with every one of us. The second great subject we find here is this. We read here of the beginning of the story, of the specifics, if you will, of the coming of Jesus to save us. God begins to talk to Abraham about some things that are important to all humanity, to every person. God did tell Abraham that he was going to give him a land, and he did, right? I mean, listen, folks. Abraham did travel. He did follow God. He did obey God. Now, sometimes, like I said, he got in trouble, but God really blessed him. Okay, now I could go off into something about capitalism right here, but I won't. I had to make sure that I won't do that, so don't do that, CB. But here's the deal. God really did bless him and make him a great man. He gave him a land unbelievable. He gave him everything, and he prospered him, and he did make him a great nation. As a matter of fact, the Hebrews, they're still with us today, right? Their lineage has gone on and on and on and on forever, although the world, if you will, has tried to wipe them out. Satan has fought those people forever, but God has maintained them as a people, and that gives us some witness to the greatness of the gospel here that we're going to talk about. God told Abraham that we would give him a land. He told him he would make him a great nation, and he did that. We know that's true. History, human history says that is true. But he also told him that in you, meaning Abraham, in you, all the families of the earth will be blessed. And this is why I titled this message today, A Christmas Blessing. Listen, folks, many, many years later, God really did fulfill that promise. When God said, Abraham, in you will all the families of the earth be blessed. And we could say, because of you. Or what I, in the best way to exegete that, is because of what I'm going to do in you and with your lineage, all the families of the earth will be blessed. When you get to the very first book of the New Testament, Matthew, you find that wherein God spoke to Abraham in Genesis 12, 1 through 3, and continuing really all the way through Abraham's life, we find the fulfillment there. Listen to Matthew 1:1. It says, the record of the genealogy of Jesus the Messiah, the son of David, the son of Abraham. Now I'm going to skip all the way to the 17th verses. A verse. Now why am I doing that? Well, you might think that I'm being merciful to you by not reading all that to you. No, I'm being merciful to me because it's hard sometimes for me to pronounce all those names. Okay? But there are 28 generations right there. Listen to the 17th verse. So all the generations from Abraham to David are 14 generations. And from the deportation to Babylon to the Messiah are 14 generations. What was God saying there in the first book of the New Testament? He was saying, the promise I made to Abraham back there when I led him out of his father's land to bring him to the promised land, I am fulfilling that in my son, Jesus. Okay, and that is the true Christmas blessing to us. What God had promised to Abraham all those thousands of years ago was fulfilled in Jesus. The fulfillment is in Jesus. Listen, everything about the world is about Jesus. You say everything right now? Yes. You mean Putin's about Jesus? Yes. You mean our economy's about Jesus? Yes. Everything's about Jesus. What do you mean, preacher? Johnny's really happening bad. That's right. We are a fallen race. And all of our stories combine into one story, and that is how God is going to redeem his creation. And my friend, he's going to do that. And he is doing that. He's redeeming individuals one by one now as he saves them. Just like it says in the book of Acts that he adds unto the churches. I'm going to paraphrase, as he sees fit. When Jesus saves people, he's redeeming people. He's redeeming his creation. But I guarantee you this, there's coming a time when he's going to redeem it all. Why? Why do I say that? Because the scripture teaches in the last book, in several books, in Daniel also, God is going to bring about a new creation. Heaven, new heaven, new earth, and yes, a new Jerusalem. All of it. Why? Because God is a redemptive God. Never forget that. When we say that God is a redemptive God, what are we saying? He loves his creation. He loves you. You think, we all think sometimes, well, I'm not lovable. Well, that's true. We're not. We're not really not very lovable. Okay? Even in our gushiest moments, we're not. But God loves us anyway. And he loved this man Abraham anyway. I mean, Abraham was a rascal, you know that? Well, the hard story, well, he did it twice, actually. But one of the really strange stories, God said, I'm going to take you to a land I want you to go to. I'm going to make you a great nation. So he travels over there. God's blessed him. For whatever reason, really and truly, I mean, I know there was a famine, but there's always going to be a famine. Abraham does what? I'm going to Egypt. I'm taking off to Egypt. And he does. What happens when he gets there? Well, obviously, Sarah was one more knockout beautiful girl. Okay? I mean, hey, he was. He gets off there. And don't forget this about these people. Abraham was not 21 years old when he took off to Egypt. He was over 75 years old. Sarah had not just graduated from high school as a cheerleader. She is old. But God preserved them better than Mary Kay, I guarantee you that. Because when they got down to Egypt, what happened? Abraham says, hey, Sarah, honey, now listen closely. You are a gorgeous woman. And some of these Egyptians down here, they're going to take note of that. And they might just kill me. Because the best way to get you is to kill the husband. So I'm going to tell you what I want you to do. I'm going to tell you my sister. Now, folks, in any culture, that's low down. It don't matter what culture you're in, that's low down. Okay. But he did it anyway, and God had to redeem him by dealing with the king of Egypt. He did do all that, and then he did it again at another time. But the truth is, folks, listen to me. People are sinful, but God still calls us to be saved. And everyone in this building ought to be happy about that today. You ought to be glad. Why? Why? Because it doesn't matter who you are. It doesn't matter what you've done. God loves you anyway.
Amen.
He really does. Now that does not give us a free license to do anything we want to. That's not what I'm saying. That's not what I'm saying at all. But God has a plan to say the Bible to people. Some days Abraham acted like the prince of God, and in other days he acted like a dog of hell. I mean, that's just true. But God loved him anyway. I want you to get that. And God chose him to bless the world through. Not because he was perfect, but because God intends to do what? What did he say in Titus? To save sinners. Get that idea. Listen to this. What God had promised to Abraham all those years ago was indeed, as we said, fulfilled in Christ Jesus. Paul the Apostle reveals this to us in his writings. This is amazing. In Galatians 3:8, the Scripture, foreseeing that God would justify the Gentiles by faith, preached the gospel beforehand to who? To Abraham, saying, all the nations will be blessed in you. So then those who are of faith are blessed with Abraham the believer. Those of faith. How am I born again? By faith in Christ Jesus. Do I work to make myself a specimen that God just walks along in the cool of the day, so to speak, and says, Well, I'm looking down here. Wow. Well, there's Nick. He is so cool right now. I'm just going to reach out and save old Nick. No! That's not how that works. You don't get yourself ready to get saved. You can't, because you are sinful. You say, well, I didn't do anything today. Right. Maybe tomorrow. The deal is, God saves us why we are. Listen to this. And he does it by what? Faith. And by faith we're blessed with Abraham. By faith in who? Abraham? No. He's like we are. He messed up. He did crazy stuff. We are saved by faith in the one that the true promise was made to, and that was Jesus. Listen, I continue. Paul went on to state in verse 16 of the same chapter, chapter 3 of Galatians. Now the promises were spoken to Abraham, watch, and to his seed. Again, singular. Now watch this. He does not say, and to seeds. I mean, Paul is very specific with it. He's showing us this very, very plainly. There's no theory here. This is reality. This is the word of God. Watch this. As referring to many, but rather to one, and to your seed. And then what does he say? That is Christ. The promises were spoken to Abraham and to his seed, right? Now let me ask you a question. When God made the promise to Abraham that he was going to make him a blessing, you know, to all the families of the earth, where was Jesus? He was sitting there right at the right hand of the Father, like he has been in eternity past, like he shall always be in eternity future, like he is right now in eternity present. There was only that one intermission when he came to earth, right, to save our souls. Other than those theophanies, when he came and he actually visited Abraham a couple of times, he really did do that. But listen, where was Jesus? He was right there. Who did God promise this to? As he promised it to Abraham, the promise was made to the Son. To do what? Save sinners. And had he promised this even before he promised it to Abraham? Absolutely. Again, I remind you, I love this passage in Titus. He promised before anything was ever created to do what? Save sinners. That's the good news of the gospel, my friends. That's real. You know, this promise was made to Christ to save all. Well, why would God promise that? Because God knew that Jesus would come. Just like the story of Matthew continues that we were looking at there in Matthew 1. Jesus would be born of the Virgin Mary. Jesus would grow up as a perfect person. Jesus would be hated and despised by humanity. Jesus would be crucified. Jesus would be buried. And Jesus did, in fact, rise from the dead. So what was God saying? All of that you're going through, all of the punishment I'm going to put upon you, I promise you, it is not for nothing. You shall be what? Glorified. That's what Jesus was praying in the 17th chapter of the Gospel of John. It is time to glorify you and glorify me. How did he understand that? He knew he was going to the cross, folks. That's what Christmas really. Oh, yeah. And look, I'm not mocking singing Jingle Bells. I sang Jingle Bells. Just nobody likes to hear it. I put up Christmas trees. I danced with Santa Claus. Boy, have I danced with Santa Claus. That don't bother me in the least bit. God knows the reality is it's about Jesus. And that's what I want you to get today. I want you to walk out here today knowing one thing. You don't need to know me. You need to know that Christmas is about Jesus.
Amen.
Always.
in verses 28 and 29 of the same chapter. Listen to this, and this is wonderful. I started talking to you about this just a moment ago, but this is where you need to understand. What I'm about to read to you will let you know that it don't matter who you are. It don't matter if you were born under a star or in a mud pit, friend. I want you to hear this. Paul said in the same chapter, Galatians 3, 28 and 29, there is neither Jew nor Greek. Now when he says Greek, that's talking about all of us, okay? Because everything that was not considered a Jew to the Jews was a Gentile, okay? We're just a bunch of Gentiles out here as far as they're concerned. Now some of you may be Hebrews, all right? And that's just fine dandy. I'm going to tell you something, I'm a Hebrew now too. I'm an Irish Hebrew. Yeah. Listen, stay with me. Neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither slave nor free man. There is neither male nor female. For if you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's descendants. Heirs according to promise. What's the guy saying there? What was Paul saying? He was saying, look, boys, it don't matter who you are. And Paul would write in Philippians, I am a Hebrew of the Hebrews, a Pharisee of the Pharisees. If anybody could make it to heaven on his own, I can do it because I was the toughest Jew around. That's written. Read it. Just there. But what's he saying right here? He's saying, it doesn't matter who you are. If he had been writing today, he would have wrote it. It don't matter if you were born under a star or under a mud bank. If you repent of sin and believe the gospel, you can be a child of God. As a matter of fact, the truth is you will be one if you do. Absolute fact. Oh, it's a wonderful thing. That, my friends, is the blessing of Christmas. It really is. God promised to bless all the families of the earth through Abraham, and he did. He did. He sent Jesus on that first Christmas, as we call it, long ago. Why did he send Jesus? Like I told you a while ago, because we've all sinned, and we've all fallen short of the glory of God. All of us are sinful. Since the time of Adam and Eve in the garden, all the families of the earth, we've been cursed with sin. Like we were talking last, it was right back there when they took that forbidden fruit. From that point on, we're all cursed with the curse of sin. We're sinful. We do crazy stuff. And I get up, I turn on the news, and here this message in Colorado. Now I'm just going to be playing with you people. I want you to hear me. I have no fan of playing parable. Not whatsoever. I'm not. Never have been. Never. I have no fan of abortion. And you'll find when you come to your Sunday school lesson on the third Sunday in January, I wrote the motion that made that happen years and years and years ago. And I want to tell you something. It is wrong to go places and shoot folks because you disagree with them. That's crazy. Okay? That's just nuts. That can't be justified. So you get up and you read that stuff, you see that on the news, and you think, well, the world's gone nuts. Well, it has gone nuts. I want to tell you something. It's always been gone nuts. Mary, where is she today? Now, let me off on that syntax, because that, you know, that really illustrates it. The world has always gone nuts. Why? Because Adam and Eve sinned and we ate the fruit too. But the great thing, the great gift of God, even though we've sinned, God has decreed to bless the families of the earth and all the people of the earth with the blessing of what? It's really who? It's Jesus. Jesus came to die in our place for our sins. He paid the price that I could not pay. Plain language that I understand easily and have understood all my born days, Jesus paid the ante. Jesus covered the table for us, as far as I'm concerned. You can say, that's a terrible way to say that. My life was a terrible way to do it. So was yours. Jesus covered. Jesus paid the debt. He paid the ransom for my sin. That's what this event that we all call
Christmas, and there's nothing wrong with calling it that, is really all about. We all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. But, and according to Romans 6:23, what's the truth? The wages of sin is death, no doubt. No doubt. But, that's a wonderful word sometimes, right? Except when your kids say it to you when you try to get them to do something. The word but the gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus, our Lord. That's what this season's about. That's why I'm here to celebrate. Don't go around being a bomb humbug when you see people and you say, oh, they don't understand the meaning of Christmas. You're standing right in the same line, paper, the same junk that they're standing. Sure. The lost world's never going to understand until they become saved. So quit beating on them and start singing the praises of Jesus. Don't go out of here.
I forgot Christmas and somebody put up the tree right after Halloween.
Well, so what? We usually put ours up during a specific football game, the third Saturday in November. Can I get an amen? And normally we're happy. So what? Why do we waste time with all that? What we need to do is major on what we really know, and that's that God sent Jesus to save sinners. So when somebody out there at the Walmart or wherever it is don't say to you, it drives me nuts. Because Christians get this, I'm so good. And you go up to some poor kid that's just trying to work, pay their way through some school. Somewhere, they're at some cash register, and they've been told, if you say Merry Christmas, we'll fire you. And that poor kid says Happy Holidays, and then some indignant, self-righteous, sanctimonious, pious pig of a Christian says, it's Christmas! That stinks. It just stinks. And that's when we're being hypocrites. That poor baby's going to have to say that because she can't. Somebody's going to yell at her if she don't. Somebody, some member of PETA or something. That's not the wrong one. Some other group. This one hates me. I don't want to leave my dog out. Some group comes along and they hear that baby say Merry Christmas. They run to the manager and they hit that company fire. Don't do those kids that way. Just say, Merry Christmas to you. Be nice. That's how we need to be. I get tired of some of that crazy stuff. We're crazy sometimes. It's Christian.
You're so cool. I've never seen.
And we yell at people, and then when we leave, what do they remember? They remember how stinking mean we were. Lady come up to you waiting on your restaurant. She's doing everything she can. She's got 3 or 4 young and she's trying to feed and take care of. At the end of things, she says, have a happy holiday. And then you say, I was going to tip you, but now I'm not. You should have said Merry Christmas. The truth is, you stingy rascal, you weren't going to tip them anyway. Season because we are blessed because Jesus came to save our rotten souls.
Amen.
And we have repented of sin and believe the gospel we're saved. That's just the truth. And we ought to be glad to have that. We ought to treat people nice. Because see, here's the end of the day. Some people may hate me and cuss me and spit at me, but at the end of the day, they're going to hell unless they receive Jesus. Okay? And it don't matter if they do it early or late. They don't receive Jesus. And so when I get to heaven, the Lord's not going to take a rag and wipe away all the cussing off of me or somebody cussed me because I was one of his children. Because I want to tell you something, you cannot find in Scripture, not one place, where God apologizes to anyone who follows him for suffering on his cause. And that's not in the Bible. Isaiah didn't get to heaven and God say, "Man, Isaiah, I'm really sorry that they sawed you in two." God didn't say that. God didn't say, "Well, Paul, I should have told you I was going to cut your head off, but you know, hey, I forgot." That's not what God said. God said one thing: welcome in, good and faithful servant. And that's the same thing God's going to say to us. What he's going to wipe away from us is the tears. It's not going to be our tears because we got treated bad. Only it's going to be tears because we know that we do not deserve what we're about to get. That's heaven. That's the truth. Now, if you're here today and you don't know Jesus, I've done my best to kick out every stone out from under everything that we who know Jesus stand on and fuss at you. I've done my best to do that. I've done my best to say to you what Paul said in Galatians 3:28. The ground is level up with the cross. There are no ladders. There are no statues. It's just that. And it's a place where sinners assemble to meet Jesus. So I don't care what somebody's done to you or said about you, my lost friend. I don't care how many Christians have acted ugly. I don't care how many hypocrites you know, and I don't care how many hypocrites you know in this church. Okay? You say, if you were to say, "Preacher, is hypocrites in that church?" Yeah. What revelation? I know there are. I know that. You know that. God knows that. The whole world knows it. But here's what's still true, man. You are accountable to God. The sign has been given to you by Abraham, by the shepherds, by the wise men, by Mary, by Joseph, by the writers of the Gospels, by the writers of the epistles. Jesus has come to save your soul if you repent of sin and believe the gospel. So, Trish, if you'll come right now, I want to give you an opportunity to do it. No matter who you are, what you've done, it don't matter what you haven't done. Maybe you've been just as good as God. You've been mama's baby all your life and done the right things. And every time you walk by, they pat you on the head and say, "I thank God you're my baby." Maybe that's true too, but I want you to know, you don't repent of sin and believe the gospel, you're as lost, as the worst person you can think of that's in hell right now. You're as lost as Hitler. That's just true. Today's the day of salvation. Let God give you the blessing of Christmas that was planned before you were ever lost. It's the best one. That's Jesus. Father, have your way in our lives. Change our lives according to your will. It's Christmas time, Lord, and there are lost people that need to be saved. You know that, though. I would say that. You know it. So, Father, I ask you, I plead with you now. What I'm supposed to plead with you is that you would speak to people by the power of your Holy Spirit and let them know that they need you now. Help them to respond. Lord, maybe some of us are here in this kind of season. Sometimes we get to hurt. Things are not the way we think they ought to be. Lord, I need my peace to have freedom of your spirit to come and kneel here and pray and just talk to you about whatever they need to. God, I'll do that. In Jesus' name we pray.